board member of the YWCA, and I am really, really, really happy to welcome you to the inaugural summer series of our Stand Against Racism. This series is an extension of something we experimented with back in September, and we wanted to have a series of talks and where we talked about different issues in racism, and to have the voice of young people telling across the generations their experiences with racism, so that we would not walk away thinking we all knew what it was about. The idea is that it's continuing, and that people of different generations are experiencing racism at different levels, and that's what makes our mission relevant. That's why we have to continue doing this. Our intern this year is a PICS intern, and Taylor came to us after we interviewed her, and I was telling Taylor that upon interviewing her, we couldn't believe that she was real. Taylor basically grew up at the YW. She went swimming over at the YM. She understood our mission before we could fully articulate it to her. And the role that she plays is that of the missions intern. So she expands on the efforts of the missions committee of the YWCA, and she allows us to continue to talk about racism throughout the summer, so that we are not saying that our single stand against racism is a one-day event. It's a 365-day event. And so we're really, really happy and thankful to you, Taylor, for organizing the series.
Right. Thank you.
Now, there's enough of us, we're a nice comfy group, so I thought perhaps if we went around in a circle and introduced ourselves before I introduce our speaker, that would be a cool thing, right? So starting with another one of my missions committee members.
Okay. I'm Rhea Armington, and I'm a member of the board as well. Learning a lot about the board in the last few months, and I'm excited to be here. I'm a diversity consultant, and there's never enough in my learning. There's a lot to learn, and I'm here to listen and learn.
Hi, I'm Kate. I'm going to be a senior at Lawrenceville School this fall, and I've been volunteering with the Y for about 4 years now. Mm-hmm. And I just found it really empowering, just the mission of the Y, and I'm really excited today to learn more about racism in higher education, because that's a topic we've been talking a lot about in my school, so I just like to see different perspectives.
Mm-hmm. I'm Taylor. I'm the social justice intern this summer at the Y. I'm also a rising junior at Princeton University in the sociology department. I'm getting certificates in gender and sexuality studies and African American studies as well. And I'm really excited for this event. Thank you all for coming.
Hi, I'm Jenny, Taylor's mom, the proud mom. And I'm very happy to be here to learn more and hopefully spread the word and help out.
My name is Barbara Fox, and I'm here as a board member of Not in Our Town, and I hope to try to help publicize these wonderful events. We partner sometimes with the Carl Field Center, so I'm especially glad to be at this one. If I get up during the presentation, I've got a leg problem that sometimes doesn't allow me to sit for a long time. So I'm not bored, I'm just going to kind of move around a little bit. It's an age thing.
Hi, I'm Jennifer Piron. I'm from West Windsor. I actually have only been part of the Y through this series, having gone to an event earlier this year. And I work in global public health at doing policy research and communications work.
My name is Bess Spiro Lee. I'm actually a social studies teacher, early American history, in the South Brunswick School District. Believe it or not, I just watched 13th for the first time last night. This is to say that I've been working very hard to try to figure out the best way to construct a curriculum to raise awareness around these issues. My daughter, Miriam, who's also a rising junior and close classmate and friend of Taylor's, has educated me more than I can possibly express. We've also been working with the Princeton Psychology Department, a couple of the professors there, to try to start talking about some of the issues that we are facing or not facing.
Hi, my name is Allison Simi. I'm connected through the Y because I'm on the Next Gen board here. And I'm interested in higher education, in particular because I just got my PhD from Princeton. So, super interested. So, super interested in this in general. Thank you for organizing this. I'm excited to be here as well.
You have to introduce yourself, Doc, or something.
Always.
Can you tell us what your PhD was in before we let you?
Yeah, it's in chemical and biological engineering.
Woo!
Yeah, I'm not really into
so
awesome.
She is no slacker.
I don't know if I'm going to follow that. Right. I just said, I don't know how to follow that. My name is Sam Bobla. I'm the new director of fund development here at the YWCA Princeton. And I feel very closely tied to the mission because I am a woman of color. So the mission speaks directly to my lived experience every single day. So this series particularly I'm interested in. So I'm just excited to be here and learn and be a part of the discussion.
And I'm Donna Maywar. So I facilitated one of the talks at the Stand Against Racism, and some of the feedback from our table was like, let's keep the conversation going, and feedback from the organizers of that were like, we're going to keep it going. And I was on campus and I saw the flyer and I saw that Tania was the first speaker, and I'm like, yeah, with that, but really just excited. And thank you again, Taylor, that yeah, we're keeping the conversation going. So who knows.
I'm Jill Franco. I am an LGBTQ community activist, educator, consultant. I came to one of the intergenerational talks, I guess, in the spring. And then I facilitated one of the tables for the Stand Against Racism event. I'm a former high school teacher. I also, right now, I work at Educational Testing Service, but I facilitate the LGBTQ support groups at High Tops in Princeton. That's how I got involved with this.
Hi, I'm Yaina Moore, born and raised here in Princeton, at a time when the Y was a segregated facility. I hope that it's moved far beyond that. I haven't attended many Y events in a long time. I know that there are many having these discussions about racism in the community, such as NIOT and others who are trying to approach it from various perspectives. I certainly experienced my own level of racism while a student at Princeton University, and I was in the School of Architecture, pressing them to move forward beyond their white male orientation, so much so that they did hire as their new dean a woman
Marshall.
Who I recommended, and a lot of things have slowly changed there, but I think that there is still a lot of work to do, not only there, but in our community. Regard to racism in education as well as higher education. So I'm very happy to be here because I know Cheryl and she's working hard, and I'm interested in supporting her as well.
Hi, everyone. I'm Judy Hutton, the CEO of the YWCA, and very proud of the Stand Against Racism, probably because it was a joint collaboration between Trenton and Princeton many, many years ago. And it started, what started as a one-day event, just to say, let's make it comfortable for people to talk about racism, progressively moved to a national event that says, we can't comfortably talk about it. We need to be uncomfortable when we're talking about it and keep it going all year. So very proud about that. I was trying to convince my husband to come because I thought it was an unbelievable topic. And he said, Princeton? And I went, oh, that's why you need to come.
That's why he needs to come.
Yes. Very happy to be a part of it.
Karen? Yourself?
Yes, I'm Karen Delk. I'm a member of the board, and it just so happens that lately, every meeting we have, the Princeton Community Television Board has a meeting, so they just ended, and so I'm here.
So that brings us to our speaker today, and it's Tennille Haynes, and she's director of the Carl Fields Center for Equality and Cultural Understanding at Princeton University. And I'm not going to say much more. I have such recollections about why there is even a Carl Fields Center. But I'm going to let you do that.
Yeah.
Okay, all right, take it away.
Happy to. Hi, right. Everyone.
Hi. Hello.
Welcome, and thank you, Taylor, for inviting me. And Taylor emailed me not long ago. I was like, absolutely, it's one of my favorite topics to talk about. This is what I do. So I'm really excited to have this conversation with you all. I do want this to be an engaging conversation. So, you know, we'll have any questions that you have in between. Let's chat. Let's dialogue about this. It's such an important topic, and it's very close to my heart in thinking about why I do the work that I do. So again, like, my name is Tennille Haynes. I'm the director of the Carl Fields Center for Equality and Cultural Understanding. I've been at Princeton for almost 6 years this month, going on 7. So I'm really excited. Time flies. I didn't believe I've been here that long. But before that, I was at Colgate University, and I worked in the Center for Leadership and Student Involvement. And before that, I was at UW College, as well, working in student activities as well. I have a master's in education, and I'm also currently pursuing my doctorate at Rutgers University in higher education part-time. I'm very excited. This is a break over the summer, and I could be here talking with you about this. Access to education, especially for students of color, like I said, has a special place in my heart. I grew up in the Bronx, New York. As well, Spanish Harlem, and then we moved to the Bronx. We grew up in a project. I started, people say, oh, you've been in school. I was like, I've been in school since like Head Start, when they had the Head Start program for inner city kids as well as you. So I've been in school for a very long time, public school, private school as well too. And it's very interesting how people of color have access to education depending on where you come from. Right. Also depends on your income level as well too, but noticing that even for you to even get to higher education, a whole lot of things have to happen before that. And especially coming to Princeton and working at private institutions, especially what you would say highly selective institutions, you see that there is even less youth of color in those institutions than you would see in other institutions, right? I went to Stony Brook University for undergrad, which was considered one of the most diverse schools in the SUNY, and it was a great experience. And, you know, I noticed that a part of what students are talking about now in their experiences, I didn't experience. Now, there's a couple of things. Either I didn't experience it because I was completely unaware of it, or coming from my background, it was where everyone looked like me as well, too, and everybody was coming from the same situation. Or the fact that maybe we weren't that diverse and it was just like, well, it was great, you know, which probably was not so. But then knowing that a lot of students, particularly the students that I work with at Princeton, are struggling. They are having a very hard time being a person of color at a highly selective, predominantly white, elite institution, right? And there's numerous reasons why that is. And, you know, we're going to get into that. We're going to talk about the whole affirmative action thing and everything else and the recent news that is coming in that Trump has reversed Obama policies on affirmative action and wants to go to a colorblind system. I have a whole spiel about the word colorblind as well and why we should not use it as well, too. But also just thinking about, you know, you know, affirmative action itself increases the numbers of Black and Hispanic students at many colleges and universities, but you still have a very high underrepresentation of Black and Latino students, right? Especially at elite institutions as well, too. And then also is even thinking about, compared to 35 years ago, we're still in the same place, right? So how much has changed as well, too? Black students are just 6% of the freshman class, but 15%. Freshmen, but 15% of college-age Americans as well. And then even though we are talking about the rate of Latino students, and excuse me, I will use the term Latino instead of Hispanic, just because Latino is just more inclusive than the term Hispanic as well, too. But even as the rise of Latinos in this country are on the rise, and they're expected to be the highest minority, or pretty much the majority of our country in numbers pretty soon, you still have more Latino, you still have an increase, you still do not have an increase of Latinos in higher education. There's still a huge gap. So the numbers are just not adding up compared to how many students should be in college versus how many students are not in college given our population as well too. And this is all going because we're talking about systematic, we're talking about systemic but also institutional racism that is happening through our policies, through our procedures, how are we recruiting students, where are we recruiting these students from, and how students are being prepared at a secondary level to enter college as well, too. But before I get into that, I do want to talk a little bit, just to give you a little bit of what the work that I do at Princeton as well, too. So the Carl A. Field Center was established, the name change was in 2009, was about 2006, and we moved to our location in 2009. So we're almost celebrating 10 years of our current location. But previous to that, it was the Third World Center, and the Third World Center was established in 1971. And that only came about because a group of Black students said we kind of had enough, and we needed a space of our own. So as you can imagine, Princeton University was not very welcoming to non-white students, non-white male students, non-white, straight-appearing male students as well, too. And for a very long time, Princeton was established as a male school, an all-male school in the 1800s, and 1700s, and predominantly catered to Southern white men. And Southern white men who were sons of plantation owners as well, too. So it was considered the most Southern of the Ivy as well, too. Princeton had a policy of not admitting students of color for a very long time. It did not probably, they had a couple incidents with students who were especially Black males kind of snuck on the campus, but then were turned away and said, maybe you don't belong here. You might want to find someplace else to go. We don't know how comfortable you would be in this space as well too. Also a policy of the presidents, especially Woodrow Wilson, who actively said, although he said we do not admit Black students, but we don't think that they would be comfortable here as well too, as maybe not be the place for them as well. So you probably did not have Black students really entering and also being full students at Princeton until about the 70s, until about late 60s coming in there as well too. So by that time, when you had an influx of Black students who were being admitted, they had no place to go on campus, right? It was a very hostile environment, particularly in the classrooms and also outside of the classrooms. You had all these eating clubs that had been there, and they weren't welcoming to anybody who did not fit into their mode of who belonged.